All right, now that we know what is a stress tensor, I would like you to move on to fluid mechanics now. Okay, so coming back to fluids. So suppose I want to apply Newton's second law, which says F is mass times acceleration. So what we are looking at is there is this fluid element, and suppose its volume is delta V. And suppose rho is the density of fluid. So I need to apply this law of the force applied on this fluid element. It has a certain mass m, and it's going to accelerate with this acceleration a. So I could actually write it as that df is given as dm times a, and this dm is essentially rho times this guy over here, maybe I will call it dv. So rho is the density and dv is the volume. All right. Now I need to figure out what is F. Okay, so F is something like an external force which is applied on this fluid element. So F is going to have two parts. So there is a body force and there is a surface force. Okay, so there is a force on this fluid element that could occur because of some force that acts within the volume of this. For example, you know, gravity. So if I talk about the weight of this object, or for example, electrostatic force, which could be because of some particles that are distributed in this and they create a force. So that would be arising because of it is per unit mass or per unit volume of the body. But then there could be a surface force. For example, friction is a surface force. Okay, so that is not related to the volume as such. So it would have, so the surface force would act on the surface of the body. So that would have to be accounted for in terms of an area. Okay, so I already know how to take care of this. So this is the body force, is example gravity. So if I wanted to look at dF body, I could write this as something like rho dV times maybe g. Okay, so g is the vector, the acceleration due to gravity, and I could take the vector according to my coordinate system, the direction that I choose. Now what about the surface force? So I need to come up with a framework for that, and that is where the definition of stress is going to be very useful. So if you kindly recall, okay, from your knowledge of physics, that how is stress related to a force. So maybe I recall for you, suppose I have a certain area, so this is a surface. It can be a curved surface, and on this I take a small area, and this has a unit normal n. So n is the unit normal to area dA. So this is the area dA. Okay. So what I am doing is on this curved surface, I have taken a small patch, and this patch has an area dA. That dA would of course be a scalar quantity, but then it has a direction because it is pointing out in a normal to this surface. So I could write dA as n times the magnitude of dA. Right? So normally we only talk about the area being a scalar, but actually it is really a vector. It has a unit normal implicit to this. So if you recall, when we defined stress, so it was something like force per unit area. This is, you already know the definition of stress. Okay. So if I wanted to look at force, then that would be stress times the area. Okay. So from this, we have for the surface force, we can actually write it as that dF surface, okay, could be the stress T dot dA, which is the area. So coming back to this figure, if I wanted to get an estimate of what is the surface force, so I would take small elements. So let me take this little element here, who has the area dA, the normal is n, and dF is the small force which is acting on this little area dA. If I knew the stress tensor, all I have to do is just dot it with this area A, and I would get the incremental force because of it. Okay, it is as simple as that. In fact, I could write this as tau dot n, and this times the magnitude of the area. So in other words, T dot n actually gives me the force per unit area, okay, acting on that little element. Okay. Very nice. Some sign convention. So I have already explained to you what this T looks like. This is the T, I have already written it on the board. So this T is a stress tensor. It has these three components which are being called normals, and then I have these shear stresses. How do I visualize them? So I can go back to a box like this, and I will try to explain you what these different quantities Txx, Txy, Txz and so on they actually mean. So let me draw a box. Suppose this is my coordinate system, and I am going to use a right-handed system. So let's say this is my x-axis, this is my y-axis, so this is going to be my z-axis. Now notice there are two indices in each of them. So let me write down a typical quantity Tij. The first index I, it refers to the face. So it could be an x face, it could be a y face, or it could be a z face. So this, for example, is the x face. Okay. This, for example, here why this is the y face. And then I could have this guy over here, this is the z face. So you'll notice that the faces are identified by the direction of the normal. Here the normal is to the x direction, here the normal is to the y direction, and this is the z face, the z direction. So that's the first index. And the second index, it actually is the direction of force. So on a given face, let's say I say the x face, I would still have forces in three directions. I could have a force along x, a force along y, and a force along z. So just to give you an example, if I drew the state of stress here, then I would have these, let's say, three directions. So I would call this quantity here as T x y, because it is x phase and y direction. This would be T x x, because this is T phase and x direction, and this would be T x and there is a z direction. Similarly, if I wanted to show this phase, I am going to be calling all of them with the y face. So this would be T y x, this guy would be T y y, and this would be T y z, and so on. Okay? So depending on the stress tensor, I could have these three quantities which are normal stresses. And you can see normal stresses are always normal to a face. So Txx is normal to the x face, Tyy is normal to the y face, and likewise Tzz would be normal to the z face. And the others are called shear stresses because they are going to lie inside the plane of a certain face. So tau xz and tau xy lie on the plane of the x face. Maybe I should simplify this in two dimensions. In two dimensions, this tensor T would have only four components: Txx, Txy, Tyx, Tyy. So this is the normal stress, and this guy here is the shear stress. And the convention here would be the following in two dimensions. So suppose this is my x direction, this is my y direction, then I would have on this face, I would have these two stresses, on this face I would have these two stresses, and here I would have something like this. This quantity is Txx, this is Txy, this is Tyy, this is Tyx, this one is tau xx, this is again the y face, sorry, the x face, and the direction is y. This one is the y face, but the direction is x, and this is the y face and the direction is y. So please notice the convention: positive x face, positive force, okay, positive x direction, so they are in the direction of the Cartesian system. This one is a negative face because it is pointing in the negative y direction, therefore the force direction has also been altered. Okay? So I have given you a state of stress in the three-dimensional coordinate system, and also if you had a two-dimensional element. I have been using this term state of stress. So this matrix here T, or for that matter this matrix T, these I would refer to them as state of stress. Okay. Now, this state of stress would vary from point to point. Okay. So if I had, let's say, a fluid which is floating on this region occupied by the blackboard, then in principle I could have a state of stress different than a state of stress here and a state of stress here. And if I use that formula over there, that the force, the surface force, could be obtained by simply multiplying with the areas, small areas, elemental areas, then in principle the surface force here and here and here, they would be different. Okay, and then there would be an imbalance and therefore my fluid can move. Okay, so we are going to use this concept of stress to actually understand how it applies to the second, how it applies to fluid as far as the second Newton's law is concerned. Another interesting aspect about the state of stress. In fact, what I can do is, I could, for example, if I call this as point O, okay, then so I could do a moment about O. So I could pass an axis, the z axis, through this and do a moment balance. So suppose I have this element where my edge is dx in this direction and dy in the vertical direction. And if I took a moment about this point, then you will notice only tau xy and tau yx would be giving me the moments, and I could write these as tau xy minus tau yx times dx dy. Of course, I am assuming that there is a unit depth inside the blackboard. So to calculate the force, I am saying, if I calculate the force because of this here, so it is tau yx times this area which is dx, and there is a unit dimension along the inside the blackboard. So this is the moment, and this should be equal to I times omega dot, where I is the moment of inertia. You can show that I would actually be given as rho dx dy times dx square plus dy square by 12. Okay, this is a small section, a rectangular section, dx and dy. And it is possible to show that this would be the moment of inertia. If I plug this formula in here and I take limit dx and dy tending to 0, because I am shrinking my element size, then it is possible to show that this would go to 0. This quantity would go to 0. So dx dy would cancel out, and this quantity would go to 0, and this would imply that tau xy is equal to tau. Okay, which means I have my stress tensor is symmetric. Okay. So stress being symmetric implies that these three normal stresses, of course, I have to find them, But in terms of these shear stresses, if I know these three quantities, because they are symmetric, I don't have to worry about these three. So overall, I have left with only six quantities and not nine. Okay.